Hey folks, welcome to Digimento Education. This is Electronic Devices and Circuits, Lecture 10. So I request you to please go through all the lectures that I have covered from Lecture 1 to Lecture 9. And please subscribe to our channel, Digimento, for the latest updates and click the bell icon. Okay, so in the last lecture, I started off with the introduction to the whole experiment. What actually it so in this case we are again we will discussing about Hall experiment, okay, and why is it used and what are the different aspects related to Hall experiment. Okay, this is Hall experiment. Okay, so this is basically the setup of a Hall experiment. This is basically the material under consideration, which we perform the Hall experiment. Okay, this can be any metal or semiconductor. So, okay, so Hall experiment is basically states that when a material, when a Hall material is placed in the transverse electromagnetic field intensity and magnetic field density and current, then electric field is induced in perpendicular perpendicular to both magnetic field density, magnetic flux density and current. Okay, so in this case in general we consider the lower plate as a deciding plate, which would decide the whether a given sample is a semiconductor or a metal. Okay, so there can be multiple case, there can be another case as well in which we would have to consider upper plate as a benchmark to decide whether the sample is a semiconductor or a metal. Okay, so in this case, if you see, when the VH is basically the Hall voltage, when the VH, so in this case we have to consider lower plate as a benchmark. So if this is the polarity of VH, we can consider upper plate to be at the ground level, and if VH is like this, which means we can say that VH is negative, this is for metal or n-type semiconductor. Okay, if a VH is like this, in this case VH is positive, this is for p-type semiconductor. Why are we considering metals and n-type semiconductor for VH to be negative? Because metals have majority charge carriers as electrons, the concentration of holes is nearly negligible, and the mass action law is not applicable in this case. For an n-type semiconductor, electrons are majority charge carriers. Okay, so we consider this plate as a benchmark to decide whether the sample is a semiconductor or a metal. Okay, W is basically the width of the sample. Okay, D is basically the thickness or height of the sample. So current is basically taken in the x direction. This is x, this is y, and this is z direction. So current is taken in the x direction, magnetic field flux density is taken in the z direction, and the induced electric field intensity is in the y direction. Okay, so irrespective of the charge, because of the Lorentz equation, the force that acts on the charge carrier is always in the downward direction for this particular setup. The force will be in the downward direction. So we can say, irrespective of the charge, carriers, whether electrons or holes, the direction of the force is in downward direction. So according to the Lorentz equation, just keep in mind that Hall voltage let's basically write down what are the values that Hall voltage and signs of the Hall voltage can take. So it's basically, you can say that the Hall voltage is an induced voltage. Okay, that's already clear from the discussion that we just had a couple of minutes ago. The range of VH is in millivolt to sorry it's microvolt to millivolt microvolts to millivolt and Hall voltage is produced between the upper and lower plates. Now let's discuss about the Hall voltage for intrinsic semiconductor metals and p-type semiconductor and n-type semiconductor. VH is 0 for intrinsic semiconductor. Okay, so VH is 0 for intrinsic semiconductor because both electrons and holes are present in equal quantity. For metals, VH is negative. For n-type semiconductor, VH is negative. For p-type semiconductor, VH is positive. Okay, understood? Now magnitude of the electric field intensity. So in this case, now we discuss magnitude of electric field intensity. So magnitude of electric field intensity, how do we define it? So we can say that electric field intensity induced, or you can say the induced electric field intensity, is VH by D. D is the depth or the height of the sample. Okay, so this is basically the E induces VH by D. If we consider the magnitude, we take the magnitude. This is volt per meter and can be in volts per centimeter depending upon the units that you take under consideration. So we can say that VH is E into D. Okay, VH is also equal to BI by rho W. VH is also equal to BI by rho W. Rho is charge density. W is the width of the specimen taken under consideration. B is the magnetic flux density, and this is in volt per meter. We define Hall coefficient, which we represent as RH, as 1 by rho, which is 1 by charge density. We define Hall coefficient as RH. So we can say that VH is nothing but RH BI by W, volt per meter. So this is basically the expression for Hall voltage in terms of RH, which is Hall coefficient, B is magnetic flux density, I current, and W is the width. So from here, this implies that VH is proportional to RH. So we can say the deciding factor, the deciding factor of Hall voltage sign is RH. Okay, understood. So from the Hall experiment, we found that mobility of the charge carriers is equal to 8 upon 3 pi sigma RH. Mobility of the charge carriers is equal to 8 upon 3 pi sigma RH. Sigma is the electrical conductivity. RH is nothing but Hall coefficient. Mu is the mobility of the charge carriers, basically the majority charge carriers. This term 8 upon 3 pi is nearly equal to 1. So we can consider it to be equal to 1. So mu is equal to sigma RH. So this expression is very much important. The relationship between the mobility of the charge carriers and RH, which is the Hall coefficient. Okay? Understood? So we quickly, now let's have a look at the charge density. So charge density is defined as charge into carrier concentration. Okay? Charge into carrier concentration, the unit will be equal to coulomb per meter cube. This is basically the charge density. This is how we define charge density. So we can say that RH, the Hall coefficient, is 1 upon charge. This is basically the magnitude of the charge. Is the charge into carrier charge density. Or the carrier density, carrier charge concentration, charge or carrier concentration. Okay, so this will be negative for metals and anti-semiconductor, and this will be positive for the p-type semiconductor. Okay, so this can be negative for metals or in general electrons, and positive for holes. Okay, so basically the value of RH is not negative. So a negative sign denotes what type of charge we are considering. Okay, so if you ever encounter RH value as minus 3 into 10 to the power 8 minus 8, okay, let me just quickly so if you ever encounter RH value as minus 3 into 10 to the power minus 3 meter cube per coulomb, so it does not mean that RH is negative. Minus sign just here denotes what type of material we are considering, what charge we are considering, what type of carrier we are considering, either it is a hole or an electron, which in this case is an electron, because RH is taking a negative sign. And the magnitude of RH will simply be equal to 3 into 10 to the power minus 3 meter cube per coulomb. So negative sign only denotes the type of charge carrier, okay? For a Hall experiment sample, RH can never be equal to 0. Okay, this is very much important. And if RH is equal to 0, that sample cannot be used for Hall experiment. That's not an eligible candidate to be used in the Hall experiment. If RH for that particular material comes out to be equal to 0, that sample cannot be used for Hall experiment. Just like, for example, insulators. for which RH is equal to 0 and can insulators cannot be used for Hall experiment. Okay, now we know the relationship between VH and RH. VH is directly proportional to RH. Now RH also depends upon the charge, so we can say that for metals RH is negative, RH value is negative. For n-type semiconductor, RH is negative. For p-type semiconductor, RH is positive. For intrinsic semiconductors, RH is very large because the carrier concentration is not that much as compared to that in extrinsic semiconductors. So for intrinsic semiconductor, RH is very large because the carrier concentration is small as compared to extrinsic semiconductor. Okay, this is important. Now, what is the effect of temperature on the Hall coefficient? We know that for an extrinsic semiconductor and for metals, the temperature does not have any effect in the change in the concentration of majority charge carriers. As we already saw, if we keep on increasing the temperature, electron hole pairs are formed, but the majority charge carriers does not have that much addition in its concentration because of increase in temperature. We already saw an example. We already solved a numerical in which after increasing temperature from 0 Kelvin to 300 Kelvin, we found that there was negligible increase in the majority charge carrier concentration. So there is no increase. You can consider a negligible change in the extrinsic semiconductor's carrier concentration, majority carrier concentration with the temperature. So we can say that for extrinsic semiconductor, RH does not change with temperature. Okay, it does not change with temperature because RH depends upon the carrier concentration, and carrier concentration is a majority carrier concentration. For intrinsic semiconductor, RH decreases with temperature as carrier concentration increases. RH is 1 by Q into carrier concentration. So this increases, this would decrease. So RH decreases with this thing. Now we know that RH is equal to mu upon sigma. Now we also know that conductivity for metals is very, very large. Okay, we can say that for metals, conductivity is of the order of 10 to the power 6. Conductivity is very large. So RH is small. For extrinsic semiconductor, conductivity, which is sigma, is small. So RH is large. Now this also further creates the dichotomy between n-type semiconductor and metals. So from here we can say that VH is strong in an extrinsic semiconductor, or you can say it is strong in semiconductor. VH is strong in semiconductor and VH is weak in metals. From the previous relation, we can see that VH is strong in semiconductor. So we can say that VH is weak and negative for metals. VH is strong and negative for n-type semiconductor. VH is strong and positive for p-type semiconductor. Understood? So weak, you can say weak in the range of microvolt. This can be in millivolt, because the range of VH is between microvolts to millivolts. Okay, so we can also experimentally calculate the mobility of the charge carrier. So mobility of charge carriers can be calculated experimentally. Okay, so there's one more experiment which we should talk about, and about which the questions have been asked in the previous examinations: Haney-Shockley experiment. So mobility of the charge carriers can also be calculated by Haney-Shockley experiment. Haney-Shockley experiment. Okay, Haney-Shockley experiment. What does it say? It is used to calculate the mobility of minority charge carriers. Okay, and is also used to calculate the diffusion constant of minority charge carriers. Because you know the relation D is equal to mu Vt. Okay. Now we know, how can we further modify the equation of VH in terms of Bi upon rho W. Okay. So we can say that VH can also be written as B into J into A rho W. J is basically the current density. Okay. We can further write it as BJA. A is W into D, because we have to consider the area of cross section through which the current is flowing. Rho W, W, W cancel. So VH we get BJD by rho. Okay, and hence we can write it as RH BJD. This is a further modification in the VH equation. So we can write it as, considering the considering n-type semiconductor, we can write this thing as VH BJD by Q into ND, considering the n-type semiconductor. RH is 1 by charge into carrier concentration, so BJD by Q ND. Okay, and magnitude of electric field intensity will be equal to VH upon D is BJ by QND, and this is basically BJ by rho, and this is basically equal to BJ RH. So this is how you can basically modify the VH equation, and based on these we can you will be given questions to solve, numericals to solve. Now let's have a look at some of the numericals. Okay, so consider this particular example, which states an N-type germanium sample has a donor density of ND is equal to 10 to the power 21 atoms per meter cube. So we are given ND as 10 to the power 21 atoms per meter cube, is arranged in a Hall experiment having B is equal to 0.25 Webers per meter square and a current density of 400 ampere per meter square. Find the magnitude of the electric field intensity. So we can say that electric field intensity, so electric field intensity is BJ by QND. We are going to consider the magnitude. Even it is an N-type semiconductor, we cannot we do not need to consider the sign of Q as minus. So since we are taking the magnitude, so we don't need to take care of the sign. Okay, so B is 0.25 into J is 400 upon 1.6 into 10 power minus 19 into 10 to the power 21, and this comes out to be 0.625 volt per meter. This is the magnitude of electric field intensity. Okay, now let's have a look at another example. Now a doped semiconductor specimen has an Hall coefficient as 3.6 to 10 to the power minus 4. So we have Hall coefficient RH is 3.6 into 10 to the power minus 4 meter cube per coulomb, and resistivity, so we are given the resistivity as 9 into 10 to the power minus 3 ohm meter. Assume single carrier conduction, what will be the mobility and density of the carrier in the specimen? Okay, so here is saying that it's a carrier, assuming the single carrier conduction, which basically implies that we are talking about the extrinsic semiconductor. Okay, so it tacitly means from the question that it means a single carrier concentration means extrinsic semiconductor. So we can say that sigma, we need to find out the mobility and density of the carrier in the specimen. So we know this thing that conductivity is what? Conductivity is 1 by 9 into 10 power minus 3, because its resistivity is given to us, is equal to 0.11 into 10 to the power 3 Simon meter inverse. Or you can say sigma is 1110 Simon meter inverse. Okay, so we need to find out the mobility. Mobility is sigma RH from the Hall experiment is known to us. So C is 110 into RH is 3.6 into 10 power minus 4. If we solve this thing, it comes out to be equal to 0.04 meter square per volt second. So this is mu, this is the mobility of the charge carriers. Now we need to find out the charge density, carrier concentration, 1 upon Q into carrier concentration. Okay, so we know RH is 3.6 into 10 to the power minus 4. Okay, so carrier concentration is equal to 1 upon 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 into 3.6 into 10 to the power minus 4. So concentration comes out to be equal to 1.736 into 10 to the power 22 per meter cube. So this is basically the carrier concentration. This is the answer. Understood? Now let's have a look at one more example. So this is example. Consider the Hall experiment setup shown below, consisting of a P-type semiconductor specimen. The specimen is placed in the magnetic flux density of minus 10 AZ cap. So in this case, magnetic flux density is in this direction, minus 10 az cap. And we discussed that magnetic flux density generally taken in plus az cap direction, and vh is basically taken with respect to the lower plate. Now in this case, vh is taken with respect to the upper plate, and magnetic flux density in this case is in the reverse direction, which is minus z direction. So you can consider the you can say that the whole experiment has been reversed. And an external voltage of 10 volt is applied. So 10 volt external voltage is applied in this case. So we can say, okay, the length of the specimen is 2 times the width of the specimen. We can say that L is 2W. It is all clear from here. Find VH developed. We need to find out the magnitude of VH, or you can say with the, along with the sign. Mu P is given to us as 500 centimeter square per volt second. Now, here comes the role of Lorentz equation. So what is the magnetic force which is developed on the charge carriers? So from here we can say that induced electric field intensity, this is the induced electric field intensity, direction of that will be from minus ax cap to plus ax cap, will be from left to right. And since it's a p-type semiconductor, holes will also move in the direction of the electric field intensity. So Fm vector will be equal to Q into drift velocity Vd vector cross of B vector. We know this thing, magnetic force acting on the charge. Q will be positive, so this will not contribute to this will not contribute any sign to the sign which will be decided by this cross product. So it will be equal to Q into Vd is mu into E induced vector cross of B vector. Okay, now this can be written as Q mu. This will be in Vx by L, this is in Ax cap direction, cross of minus 10 Az cap. Okay, so this comes out to be 100 Q mu P over L A Y cap. Okay, so this is the magnetic force direction, which means that magnetic force is acting in plus A Y cap direction, which means that the holes are experiencing the magnetic force in plus A Y cap direction. Now considering the Lorentz equation, that now what is the electric field force the a hole is experiencing? So FEI we represent with FEI. FEI is electric force due to induced Hall voltage. What is the electric force which is due to the Hall voltage? Is minus Fm vector, because net force will be equal to zero, so FEI will be equal to minus Fm vector. So we can say that QE induced is 100 Q mu P over L minus AY cap. Okay, so from here it is clear that induced electric field intensity is equal to 100 mu P by L minus AY cap. Now from here it is clear that electric field intensity direction of that is in minus Y direction. So the electric field intensity is like this. This is the induced electric field intensity direction. Direction will be in minus AY cap. So it's clear that upper plate will be positive. It's clear that VH will be positive. Because if this is positive, this is negative, then electric field intensity is destined to be directed from upper plate to lower plate. So as E induced is in minus AY cap direction, so VH is positive. Okay, So now VH will be equal to W into E induced. So W into 100 mu P by L. This is 2W, and if you saw plug in the values, you get 2.5 volt. So VH is 2.5 volt. This is the answer. Okay. Now we are now starting with a new topic, which is basically very, very important for GATE and IES. We are going to discuss Fermi-Dirac function. Fermi-Dirac function, which we represent with FE. What is Fermi-Dirac function? Okay. Now, we can also say it's basically a probability distribution. So it's all, we can also say also called as Fermi-Dirac probability distribution. So what is basically, what is the equation to represent that is f of e is 1 upon 1 plus e upon e to the power e minus ef by kt. So this is basically the Fermi-Dirac function. F of e is 1 upon 1 plus exponential e minus ef by kt, where e is in electron volt and ef is also in electron volt. So it just tells Fe just denotes the probability of finding an electron at a particular energy level. It just gives you the probability of finding an electron at a particular energy level. F of E is a strong function of temperature. As it depends on T, you can say F of E is a strong function of temperature and increases with it. Okay, and there are some misconceptions that you need to know so that it won't make any confusion to you, that F of E does not indicate how many electrons are there at that particular energy level. Okay, F of E does not tell how many electrons are there at a particular energy level. It tells you the probability of finding a particular of the electrons at a particular energy level. Okay, understood? Okay, so I'm stopping here. We shall cover the rest part of Fermi-Dirac function and many calculations related to this particular concept in the next lecture, which are very much important. So I need a separate lecture to discuss everything related to Fermi-Dirac function, because it's very, very important with respect to GATE point of view and IES point of view and PSU point of view. Many questions have been asked from this particular topic. Okay, many a topic is there which is very much important, but this topic is the most important one, is one of the most important ones. Okay, so I'm stopping here. Thank you very much, and please go through all the concepts that I covered in this particular lecture, because it's very much important. Thank you very much.